Justin and Tyler and Anna must be on their way to meeting for worship or they're going to be late. But they have to get in the buggy and go 25 miles south to the meeting house, which is the closest one down at Blue River. 25 miles, they gotta ride to get there. Okay, let's listen in while they get ready to go to meeting for worship.
Hurry, you guys, or we're gonna be late for meeting for worship. Let me help you with your hat.
Doesn't touch me. In the early 1800s, a number of Quakers came to live in southern Indiana. And from what Pat just read, we know that in 1820, these Quakers in Jackson County were allowed to have their own meeting, and the name of it was Driftwood Monthly Meeting. Now, you never know for sure, but there, we'll get back to that a minute. Today I want to share with you some of the things that are in the men's and women's monthly meeting minutes, and this will give some insight into the lives of these early settlers in Jackson County. Now, in those days, the men and women worshiped together in meeting for worship. But one time a month, they would meet in a monthly meeting for business. At that time, the partition was put down the middle of the meeting house. The women met on one side, the men met on the other side, and that's why we have two sets of minutes. So Pat's going to be reading from the women's minutes. Al is going to read from the men's minutes. Now, on the front of your handout, somebody said, "What in the world is that?" Let me explain. This is a photograph of the men's monthly meeting minutes that begins in 1820. This book itself is 15 inches long and has 639 pages. And why didn't I bring that book today instead of just a silly old picture? Because these books are stored in a fireproof cabinet in the Friends Meeting House at Azalea, and they are not allowed to leave the meeting anymore. I couldn't bring it. On page one, now You know, as an old teacher, I asked my first graders to always follow what I was asking. Page one in your book shows what I'm, the questions that I am going to answer today. First question, where did the Driftwood Quakers settle in Jackson Township, Jackson County? Now, boys, I'm sorry, you're not boys and girls, men and women, please find the very middle page, which is page 6 and 7, and there is a map. I know you all have your series or whatever in your car, but I'm still from the days of maps. I have made a skeleton map of what you are looking at in your book. I see a blue up here, a green, a red, and way over here is a yellow. Everybody find that? Good. Okay. Now, these early Quakers in Jackson County settled just south of Seymour, right here is Walmart. Anybody from this town, I know the lady from Cincinnati doesn't know where Walmart is, but anyhow, here's Walmart, I gotta be careful, I'm getting too close, sorry, right here's Walmart, Steak and Shake, Home Depot, Applebee's, now you know where that is. The first meeting was down here at the green one that says number one. It is 2 miles south down that road. Now then, if you will turn back to page 3, you'll find a pretty picture, I hope. The picture at the top of the page shows a grain bin. Why do I have a picture of a grain bin? Because as I have driven down that road and am looking at that T intersection, I'm looking directly at a grain bin. But look at your picture, and to the left of the grain bin are some straggly trees. See them? That is the location of the Driftwood Meeting House, School, and Cemetery from 1820. That's a long time ago. The Meeting House, the school are gone, but the cemetery is still there. However, there's a problem. For you to get back to that cemetery, you have to cross private property. Okay, now, in 1819, the deed to this property mentions this little stream right here, and I am told that the name of that stream was also Driftwood, thus Driftwood Monthly Meeting. So there's where we got the name for this monthly meeting. Now, this was fine for a while, but then we have a problem. Al, after about 30 years, read the problem from the men's monthly meeting minutes.
The members of Driftwood Meeting, believing it right to move their meeting house and graveyard on account of the location being low and wet, the trustees asked the approbation of this meeting to sell 3 acres of the old lot, reserving 1.5 acre containing the old graveyard.
It was low and wet, and so they decide to sell that, except keeping the graveyard, and they are going to relocate. They did not close. They relocate over here to the red spot. See the red spot? They started here. They did not close that meeting. They just picked up and moved over here. And over here,
the monthly meeting purchased 1.5 acres from Richard Cox for $52.50. Wow-wee. And they built a new meeting house, a new school, and made a new cemetery. Now, you got that clear from the minutes. We know that that is fact. This did not close. They just relocated over here. All right. Now, after many years in 1887, so many of these people moved away to Kansas that eventually this meeting did close. But many years after they moved, the bottom photo back here where we had the grain bin is a photo taken just a few days ago of the cemetery that's still there. Okay, now then, we have one more pretty color. That one was green, red, and now there is a yellow one over here. Well, after this meeting closed, the people over here at Jaketown said, "We're still Quakers. We want a meeting." And 6 years after this one closed, they said, "Okay, you can have a meeting over here." Read that request out of the minutes. Out.
There is a request to have a meeting for worship established on the first day of the week in the vicinity of Jaketown, Jackson County, Indiana, to be known by the name of New Driftwood.
Now, this is your opportunity to ask me a question. Oh, good. Okay. All right. Now then, I've got the groundwork made. Let's see what the next question is on page one. Now we get to talk about the real thing now that we've established it. Where, okay, we did the where did. Where did these Quakers come from? Where did these Quakers come from? Now, you've got to understand that everything I'm saying today is authenticated in either the women's minutes or the men's minutes. Someone's a little bit ahead of me. The Driftwood meeting had members who came from different places and had different backgrounds. Now, the interesting thing about Quakers back in 1820 is that they had a certificate of membership, and when they moved, they simply got that certificate from their meeting, they carried it over to this meeting, and it's in our minutes when they brought it to us. Therefore, we know where some of these came from. Al, read me about Job.
Received a certificate for Job Newby from Stillwater Monthly Meeting, Ohio.
This place in Ohio was very close to the Pennsylvania line. How many of you remember your fifth grade history? Come on. Hey, there's one that remembers fifth grade history. Remember in England, back in the 1600s, the Quakers were being persecuted. The king owed a debt to Admiral Penn. And he said to Admiral Penn, "Instead of giving you money, how about I give you some land over here in this godforsaken country on the other side of the ocean?" Yeah, right. Wait, so Admiral Penn gave that to his son, William Penn. William Penn gathered up many, many Quakers who were persecuted, and over a period of time moved them over to what state do you reckon William Penn would have founded? All right, you're right on it. Penn for William Penn. Now the hard part. How many of you remember your Latin? What does, oh, somebody does. What does Sylvania mean?
Woods. Forest or woods?
Woods. Pins. Woods are pins for, hey, we got one smart guy, remembers his life. So Pennsylvania is Penn's Woods. All right, there were many Quakers over there in Philadelphia. So when Joe came in here, he had come out of the kind of Quakers that knew Quakerism in the metropolitan areas and so on of Philadelphia. So now we've got Joe in here with that background, but Pat, read about Catherine and her daughters.
Received certificate for Catherine Eigler and her daughters Rebecca, Deborah, and Christina from Back Creek Monthly Meeting, Randolph County, North Carolina.
And many of these certificates in our minutes. Now remember, everything I'm telling you is what I found in the minutes, are from North Carolina. So whoever said North Carolina a while ago was right on. Oh, that took care of that question. What was the next question on page one? How did being a member of the Religious Society of Friends affect the lives of these Quaker settlers? Whoops. We're living in the wilderness of Indiana in 1820. All right, boys, ladies and gentlemen, page 11. I put a nice 11 here for you so you'd remember what I said. Are words that the Quakers were using back in 1820. And I'm going to look at one of those words because it's a word that we Quakers still use today. We have queries. Look down there in the Q's. Query. Now, I know that Larry Perkinson could say to me, a query is nothing but a question, and he's right. But the Quakers had a unique way of using a question. They had a question that you were to answer silently, and it was to make you think about your own behavior. It wasn't a rule that said, thou shalt not. But in your own mind, I want to read you a query that these Quakers in 1820 were supposed to think about. This is one of the actual queries. Are friends clear of importing, vending, distilling, and the unnecessary use of all intoxicating liquors? Here we are on the wilderness of Indiana. I wonder how these guys looked at that. Al, in our minutes, we have complaints. I want you to read four complaints. Don't read their first names. I mean, don't read their last names. Okay, Al.
Driftwood Meeting complains against Samuel for distilling spirituous liquors. Complains against Josiah for selling grain for distillation. Complains against John N. for aiding in commerce of spirituous liquors. Against John L. for his outgoings in drinking spirituous liquors to excess.
These Quakers had unique vocabularies. I'm a college graduate. I didn't know what the word spirituous, how do you pronounce that?
Spirituous.
I didn't know what this word meant, so I looked it up in the dictionary. And it's a simple thing. The dictionary definition is contained alcohol by distillation. And that's true of what they did. Okay, so let's look. Samuel was distilling it. Josiah was selling grain for distillation. John N. was selling it, and then John L. was getting drunk. But look at it this way. Their neighbors who were not Quakers may have been doing the same thing. Was it really wrong? The meeting thought it was. All right. Let's look at a few more complaints. Al, what's the complaint against Nathan?
We have a complaint against Nathan for training with the militia.
Quakers promoted peace and nonviolence. Nathan, don't join the militia, even though your neighbors do. Okay, I want you to read two complaints, one against Maximilian and one against Gabriel.
We have a complaint against Maximilian for offering to fight with one of his fellow creatures. And we have a complaint against Gabriel about striking his fellow creature.
Maximilian just offered to fight, but Gabriel didn't. Come on, Quakers were supposed to be nonviolent. Now don't you see living here and trying to live up to the Quaker wearies? We got women. What's a complaint against Elizabeth?
Complaint against Elizabeth for using profane language.
That wasn't proper, whether she was a Quaker or not. Al, what's the complaint against Jesse?
We have a complaint against Jesse for not paying just debt.
Well, he should have. And would you believe 2 months later, the minute says that he paid it and the complaint was dropped. And now, this one is interesting. I'll read the complaint, and this is from 1821, when they first came here.
Complaint against Nathan and James upon a matter of interest.
Now, Nathan had not paid James what he was supposed to, and 3 months later, after they called in arbitrators, Nathan and James reached an agreement. But it was a unique way to pay the debt. Al, read. Now, he's reading from the minutes. Read how it was settled.
Arbitrators do find that Nathan is to pay James 100 bushels of corn next fall at the usual time of gathering in good sound corn.
No more nubbins. It's to be good sound corn, and it's to be 100 bushels next fall. We haven't even planted it in February when this was said. So Nathan must expect a good crop, 100 bushels in 1821 in this wilderness that's just been... Okay, interesting. Now, one of the most common complaints is against someone who marries out of meeting. But instead of, and of course that meant you were disowned. But instead of looking at that, I want to look at the way you were supposed to do it. Pat, will you read us about John and Rebecca?
John Newby and Rebecca Littler informs this meeting that they intend marriage with each other. Rachel Ruddick and Hannah Hyatt are appointed to inspect into her clearness relative to marriage.
Two women are to go talk to Rebecca and make sure she is clear to get married. Clearness, that means they're going to check that she isn't engaged to somebody else, that her parents approve, and she's marrying somebody that's in the meeting, or someone that's in the Religious Society of Friends. And I just have to put this interjection in here. These minutes are so old, written by people that are so old, that learned their cursive so long ago, that there's a number of times I find where they use the double S. Now some of you would be aware, C-L-E-A-R-N-E-S-S. That comes back really back into the 1700s. And look, if it's 1820 and you were 60 years old, you got your education back then. And it is fascinating when I run across some of these. And at first I thought, boy, they sure can't write. And then I realized it's the double S. That's just an aside. That doesn't have anything to do with today. Okay. We got two people that would go see Rebecca and make sure she could do it. And at the same time, the groom had to go to his meeting and get the same thing. And it happens that John is a member of this meeting, but we're not going to read it, but he went. Okay, Pat, the women went and talked to Rebecca. What did they report?
The friends upon the last meeting in the case of Rebecca Littler report that they find nothing to hinder her intended marriage with John Newby. Jeremiah Morris and Hannah Hyatt are appointed to see if the marriage be accomplished agreeable to our rules and report to next meeting.
All right, they said, hey, everything's okay. The men appointed in the men's meeting talked to John and they found the same thing. Now, just for your information, have any of you ever attended a true old-fashioned Quaker wedding without a pastor? Oh, Jane has. Kathy has. Good, because our daughter chose to be married in the old-fashioned way. When it came time for the actual marriage, she said, in the presence of the Lord and before these friends, promising with divine assistance, I take thee, Joseph Ginder, to be my husband, and I promise to be unto thee a loving and faithful wife as long as we both shall live. Hey, how much more of a pledge would you need? A loving and faithful. Okay, so that was what Rebecca and John were going to exchange. At the end of meeting for worship, they were to go up front, turn toward the congregation, and then hold each other's hand and say that. And then the certificate of marriage that we're talking about, everybody there signed it. So my daughter's certificate's got a whole bunch of names on it because everybody that was there. So that was what Rebecca was to do with John. Did the wedding happen, Pat?
The friends appointed to attend the marriage of John Newby and Rebecca Littler report they attended to the appointment and no complaints.
And interesting, it was the men's meeting that was to provide the certificate that was to be signed. And it was signed and returned. All right. Now, let's get sad. In the early 1820s, it was known that if a Quaker man or woman married someone who was not a member of the Religious Society of Friends, that he or she would be disowned. In their defense, the Driftwood Quakers may have come from places where everybody else was a Quaker. And so when they fell in love with a Quaker. But they came here where there weren't that many Quakers. They fell in love with someone else that was from a different church or had no church affiliation. They fell in love, but it wasn't a Quaker. Now, do I love my chosen one enough to give up my being a member of the Religious Society of Friends? Isn't that a sad decision for them to have had to make? Now we're looking at what it was to be a Quaker here. All right, we got that. Now then we get into something that I'm excited about. Or could you see? Before I get to that, there becomes a complication. And I have a number of people here that I could see are from my meeting in Azalea. And they know that our meeting is Sand Creek monthly meeting. Well, here's what happened. 4 years after we got the meeting here at Driftwood, the people up at Sand Creek, which is just above Azalea, said, "It's too much to drive down to Driftwood for meeting for worship. We want our own meeting for worship." And they were granted their own meeting for worship. So now we have Sand Creek, we have Driftwood, but they put a stipulation on it. Driftwood has the business meeting. You can't have your own business meeting. You gotta have your business meeting in joint with Driftwood. This is fact. Later we will read the minute. Not yet, Al. That minute's later. But this makes a complication or a situation when I get excited about this library. The minutes reveal the meeting's concern for the intellectual development of these pioneers. Al, 1830. Put this in your brain. 1830. I'll back up. Read me that minute, please.
This meeting appoints Isaac Cox and William Ruddock to see if each family within its limits is furnished with a copy of the Old and New Testament.
And in 1830, I will ask my pastor, Peggy Caldwell, what version of the Bible do you think that probably was?
King James.
I agree. King James Version, probably. Every family was to have a Bible. And in my brain, I see Father sitting in a wooden rocking chair at the fireplace with the Bible in his hand. And it's a cold winter day, and the children are sitting around on the floor. And Father's reading them a story from this new Bible about David and get. Oops, wait a minute. That's just my imagination. Now, that minute about seeing everybody had a Bible had something else very important. Al, read the rest part of that same minute.
Also, this meeting appoints John S. Chawner to receive subscriptions for the purpose of furnishing a library of Friends books for the use of Friends belonging to Driftwood Monthly Meeting.
We're setting up a library. I brought the books. Inside this book belongs to the library of Driftwood Monthly Meeting. This book is to be loaned not exceeding 4 weeks. This is not a book like it. This is the book that he's referring to. This may be one of the earliest documented lending libraries in Jackson County, Indiana. This is exciting. Now, in the meeting house at Azalea, we have a collection of old books. They let me bring this one. The other book, the record books, they won't let me bring. This is in our collection of old books. Another one from that same minute was published in 1806. Think how old this book is that I'm holding in my hand because I was too cheap to go buy white gloves. There it is. Property of Driftwood Monthly Meeting. This one can only be loaned for 1 week. It's skinnier. And then I brought one more from that same minute out. And that's this one here. And yes, Jen, I read that first book and it's pretty good. I had read it. You asked the other day if I'd ever read any of these. Here's another one. This book belongs to Driftwood. This one can be loaned for 2 weeks. You got 2 weeks to read this one.
Why is it wrapped in plastic?
Come on, guys. Why is it wrapped in plastic? Somebody should have had that answer. Something happened. Exactly 18 years ago tonight. In Azalea. Something happened exactly May the 6th, 1998. Come on, somebody tell me what happened exactly. What?
A fire.
And you think they're picky about keeping our records in a fireproof tent? She's right. Exactly. It couldn't have been better to have it today. But exactly 18 years ago tonight, there was a fire that gutted the annex of the Azalea Meeting House. When the first fireman arrived, I am told, I wasn't there, I am told that the fireman told Sandra she could not go in the burning building. But he asked her, what do you want saved? She said, the collection of old books. There were 119 of these books on the bookshelves. In this corner of the annex, the fire had started over in that corner. It was spreading. The fireman went in the building. He went into that room. He opened the window. He took 119 books, a few at a time, handed them out the window to the people. Was there anybody here at that time? There's some people here that can verify. And in a human chain, he handed them out to the first person until they got over to the shelter house and put them down. Those 119 books did not burn up, but most of the books had already had heat damage or smoke damage. Heat damage, the ones that had the nice spines with the names, a lot of them are melted and you can't read it. And after they were cleaned, there still seemed to be residue of the smoke on some of them. And so to protect the books and the bookshelves, that's why some of these books are in plastic. Oh, that was my exciting thing. I wasn't here that night, but it must have been exciting for you that were there and watched the annex burn. Okay, these three books and a whole bunch more were shared by Sand Creek and Driftwood. Remember I said that they had to have their business together. These were shared. But after 21 years, I'll read the proposition in the minutes.
Proposition is laid before this meeting to divide our library so that each of the meetings of Driftwood and Sand Creek may have a separate library.
Yes, right on. Six men were appointed to do this, but with the division of the libraries between the two meetings, we need more books, don't we? Al, guess what's in, I mean, you know what's in the next minute. And Al is going to read the minute that tells the books they bought. And I am not going to have him read the whole list. I only brought three of them, and that's all that he's going to mention. And these are the books. These are not replicas. These are not like it. These are the books that Al is going to read. Okay, read that 52-minute, please.
By report of the Book and Track Committee, this meeting is informed that they have forwarded $16.50 to Philadelphia, for which they have received the following books. Two copies of Pennington's Letters.
Here's Pennington's Letters.
One copy of Kendall's Letters.
Here's Kendall's Letters.
and volumes 11, 12, 13, and 14 of Friends Library. The librarians are directed to divide the above named books according to the ratio of the Lake Division of our library.
All right. I'd love to tell about the old books, but there's one more minute that made me smile because we have a lending library and we get the same complaint 150 years later. Read this from 1865.
We, the Book and Tract Committee, think there is a manifest falling off in loans from our librarian, probably from the want of modern books.
And that's what we get now. Can't you get some more modern books in the library? And they were saying that 150 years ago. All right. Okay, now that, I love to talk about the books. Now the next question in your handout is, what mention is made of the Underground Railroad? And for you from Cincinnati, you might know something about Underground Railroad over there, but this area right here, we believe was very active in the Underground Railroad. So I have scoured the minutes. What mention is made? You know the answer. I have found no reference to the Underground Railroad in the Driftwood Monthly Meeting Minutes. Some members of the meeting and other concerned people in the community are said to have been involved, and I believe it. It's not in the minutes. The Fugitive Slave Acts required that runaway slaves be returned to their masters, and therefore the Underground Railroad was illegal, and the success of the Underground Railroad was in its secrecy. However, the Driftwood Monthly Meeting did participate in raising money to help the slaves who had already obtained their freedom and they were living in Indiana and Ohio and were poor. I'll read the minute from 1854. Now, this is before the Civil War. Read what we were doing.
The Friends continued to raise money for the colored people and report the money in readiness, and the meeting directs them to pay it to our branch committee for colored freedmen and report to next meeting.
So the meeting was helping with that. Next question. I'm afraid to ask this question. I'll ask it. Who was known as the president of the Underground Railroad? Whoa, I didn't get that. Who?
Levi.
I heard it. Somebody said it distinctly enough.
Levi
Coffin. Levi Coffin is known as the president of the Underground. Oh, yeah, you from Cincinnati should know that too. Maybe that's who I heard say. Levi Coffin moved his family to Indiana from North Carolina in 1826, and he brought his certificate of membership. He brought his certificate of membership to New Garden Monthly Meeting, which is north of Richmond. Levi Coffin was what we call an abolitionist. An abolitionist believed that the slaves should be emancipated, they should be freed tonight, right now. But his monthly meeting in Indiana yearly meeting believed there should be a gradual freeing or relocate them to colonies in Africa. And because of this conflict, Levi Coffin was disowned from New Garden Monthly Meeting in 1843. That is documented. For 16 years, Levi Coffin was not a member of the Religious Society of Friends. He had been disowned. And I'd love for him to be resurrected so I could ask him why. No, why I could ask him why he did this now. Because Pat, in the women's minutes, and it's in the men's minutes too, but she's reading, Levi came to Driftwood and requested. Read what he requested, Pat.
Levi and Catherine Coffin request to become members of our religious society. Smithy Thomas and Millicent Newby are appointed to join a life committee of men friends in visiting them and report to next monthly meeting.
Two women and two men are appointed to go talk to Levi and Catherine Coffin. Doesn't this seem simple? They've asked to become members. Can't we just say, yeah, that'd be great. But not exactly what happened. Al?
Those appointed to visit Levi and Catherine Coffin, relative to their request, reported that four of them had an interview with them to good satisfaction. After a time of weighty deliberation thereon, the meeting united, women friends concurring, in directing the clerk to correspond with New Garden Monthly Meeting and ask their consent to receive them into membership with us.
Weighty deliberation says to me, some guys didn't agree. And instead of saying, yes, Levi and Catherine, you're welcome, we welcome you, they say, hey, we're going to write to New Garden and see what, how they feel about it. Now, remember, they had disowned him 16 years ago. So, well, let's see. Okay. Now, Al, I want you to read this communication from New Garden, and I want everybody here that's an English major to listen for the longest run-on sentence that I've found. And remember, he can't breathe until the sentence is over. Okay, now, read what New Garden responded when they said, is it okay if we...
Received a communication from New Garden Monthly Meeting of Friends held at Arba, Indiana, date 11th month 19th, 1859, in case of the request of Levi and Catherine Coffin, giving their consent to our receiving them into membership with us, which was satisfactory to the meeting, and we therefore acknowledge them members of our religious society and appoint Isaac P. Cox and Livni Moffat in conjunction with a like committee of women's friends to inform them therefore and report to next meeting.
Now, rather than that being a run-on sentence, Levi Coffin is now a member. He's now a member of the Driftwood Monthly Meeting. This is exciting. How many of you noticed I was holding something up and have already found this? Page 8. I know some of you did. That was what was at the top of the page that Al just read to you. I'll let him read the others to you in a minute. But there is your proof. This is a photocopy, and I appreciate our pastor who helped reduce this from our minutes so we could get it on there. All right. Now then, he's a member of our meeting. I have problems with him and his Underground Railroad activities, but the next thing I approve of, not that it matters what I care. By 1862, as the Civil War progressed, there was a need to care for the slaves that were being freed and abandoned as the Union Army moved south, particularly through Tennessee there. Those landowners, some of them just took off and went to Texas, and here's these slaves abandoned. And Levi saw the need that somebody need to obtain food, clothing, and other needed supplies and get them to him. Now remember, Levi's up here in Indiana and Ohio. No organization existed to either send the supplies down there or to distribute them once they got there.
Levi and leaders of churches of other denominations formed the Western Freedmen's Aid Association, which took over this task. Well, that was great, but he was still very concerned. In 1864, Civil War still on, he made a visit to the South to make sure the distribution of goods to the freedmen was being done properly. As he was returning home, he had a vision. No, he felt a call to go to England to ask them to help raise money for this cause. And the directors of the association said, hey, that's a good idea. This is a copy of Levi Coffin's journal. In it he says, preparations were then made for the journey, and I was furnished with the numerous credentials. I obtained also from the monthly meeting of which I was a member a certificate of membership in the Society of Friends. Where is he a member? Driftwood. So he's got to come to monthly meeting and ask for this certificate to take to England. And we call it, in Quakerese, we call it a minute of travel. And by the way, we still do that. Remember back in 2000 when we gave one to Mike Manius? Yeah, you do remember. Okay, this minute of travel was what he needed to take with him. And so, let me see. Al, is it time for you? Yes. Again, you've got page 8. This is the middle one that he's going to read. Levi came to monthly meeting, and let's read this actual certificate of travel.
Levi Coffin, who has a prospect of traveling in Europe on business, requests a certificate showing that he is a member of a religious society of friends. This, therefore, to certify that he is a member of this meeting with whom we have unity, and recommend him to the kind sympathy and care of friends where'er his lot may be cast. Signed in and by direction of Driftwood Monthly Meeting of Friends, Indiana, held at Sand Creek, 5th month, 7th day, 1864.
Now remember, when they're having these monthly meetings together, they're at Sand Creek 1 month, Driftwood next month, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Now, going back to his journal, he did go. He spent over a year in England and Europe, and he just now has gotten on the ship to come back to the States, and he says, I left England with a thankful and cheerful heart. Over $100,000 money, clothing, and other articles for the freedmen had been forwarded to our association in Cincinnati during the year. $100,000 in 1864. Wow. Fact. Now, we gave him this minute of travel. You know what he's got to do with it? He's got to bring it back. And Al, the bottom one on that, Al's going to read it to you. It's when he came back and told us a little bit. Read it, Al. And this one's at the Driftwood meeting.
Our beloved friend, Levi Coffin, now returns the minute granted in 5th month, 1864. He also gave an interesting and satisfactory account of his travels in Great Britain, Ireland, and France, and of the manner of in which way was made for the introduction of the benevolent cause in which he was laboring. He also expressed that the visit was terminated very satisfactory to himself, which is satisfactory to the meeting.
Levi Coffin was part of Driftwood Monthly Meeting. Now, got to deal with one more thing that really affected these settlers here. Quakers are known for their testimony against war. What is recorded in the minutes about the men who were members of the meeting and voluntarily joined the army in the Civil War? Civil War began
of 1861. Was slavery wrong? Should the Union be preserved? Each young man had to make the difficult decision about whether war was the way to settle these disputes. Now, his friends who were not Quakers may have been eager to show their patriotism and fight for their country. This would have had an influence on the young Quaker men, even though his meeting said war was wrong. Okay, there were a few who did join the Union Army. Now, the Driftwood Monthly Meeting has to decide how to deal with that, because if you do that, you're disowned. But I can think of, okay, going on. They took no action until after the war was over. Now, men who violated the peace testimony were disowned, but a soldier who wanted to maintain his membership would be allowed to produce an offering. An offering is nothing more than a written statement that says, I was wrong, I'm sorry. And some of them did that. And if the meeting accepted it, he remained a member in good standing. But we're going to look now at the example of another young man. Okay, Al, men's minute, read the complaint. Only use his first name for a reason.
A complaint was produced to the meeting against Elwood for voluntarily engaging in military service. William Cox, Isaac Cox, and Thomas Lindley are appointed to visit him and report to the next meeting.
That's very simple. We're going to go talk to him. We want him to sign this statement and say, I was wrong, I'm sorry. Okay, read what the results of their visit.
Those appointed at the last meeting to visit Elwood on account of his violation of discipline report, they had an interview with him, and he is not in a condition of mind to condemn his conduct in going into military service. Richard Cox, James Cox are appointed to prepare a statement of disavowment against him, women friends concurring, and inform him thereof.
He was disowned. And I don't know if anybody's here today that knows that is a descendant of him, but it's possible. Okay. That gives some of the what it was to be a Quaker here at that time. Now we got to do something about these meetings. I told you briefly, you know, they started here, they relocated over here. And by the end of the Civil War, many of these had moved to Kansas. How do I know? Pat, read.
Mary Eliza and Hannah Moffat jointly requested a certificate of removal to Cottonwood Monthly Meeting of Friends, Kansas.
In the minutes, many of these went to Cottonwood Monthly Meeting of Friends in Kansas. It is documented they did go to Kansas, a lot of them. Now, I want you to read this minute for the people who are here from San Francisco area meeting. Read it.
It is the judgment of this meeting that it would be best, owing to the number of friends residing at this place, that the monthly meeting hereafter be held at Sand Creek. Also, that the name of the meeting be changed to Sand Creek Monthly Meeting.
Now, you people from Azalea, there's nothing but a name change. As he read, the name of the meeting is changed to Sand Creek Monthly Meeting. Think upon that. Okay, we deleted some, didn't we? Okay,
read about 1887.
Committee on Driftwood meeting report, there have been no meetings held since last report. The committee is united that the meeting should be discontinued, with which this meeting concurs. This action is to be forwarded to the quarterly meeting.
All right. It hadn't been, okay. From one report, nobody had been in the meeting. Okay. Driftwood meeting was closed. Red spot is closed. 1887. And immediately, the trustees come and say, we want to sell the property. Let's don't wait around. So the trustees have said, we want to sell it. What did the meeting say?
Sand Creek Monthly Meeting of Friends are united in granting the trustees the privilege of selling 1 acre of ground and meeting house and schoolhouse known as Driftwood property and apply proceeds to repairs of graveyard at that place.
Here's a picture of that graveyard we're talking about. And Al, we sold the property to George Stahl. Read about it. I want to know how much money goes in the cemetery fund.
Trustees of the Driftwood property report that they have made a sale of the property as specified in minutes of 9th month, 3rd day, 1887, for $109.50.
So that $109.50, Azalea, in 1887 started the Driftwood Cemetery Fund, which happens to still be in our meeting today. This is a picture. When you take that drive out there, you'll see that pretty thing. And I happen to know that there's a person here today named Emily whose great-grandmother was buried in this cemetery in 2002. And I know I was out there the other day and the tombstone said 2012. It's still an active cemetery. And you've got all that information in your center of how to reach that cemetery, which is right there. All right. Now, I have to interject one more thing before I can finish it, and that is on page 9. This is one of my favorites. Caleb Elliott. Caleb Elliott was one of the early Quakers in the Driftwood Minutes, and instead of burying his people in the Driftwood cemeteries, he made a plot out on his farm, and this farm is just south of present-day Seymour. You people from Seymour know that when World War II came along, the government came along and they said, we'll pay you this for your land. Take it. We're making an air base out there. So the government bought the Elliott Farm and it became part of Freeman Field, which is used as a military base to train Air Force pilots. But what's the government going to do about this cemetery that's inside a military base? Right where they need those planes. Okay, so what they did, they contacted the Church at Azalea, Sand Creek Monthly Meeting, let's say, and said, can we buy some lots up there in the Sand Creek Cemetery so we can move these bodies? Yeah. Died in 1846. Okay, Al, read what happened.
The October minute says, Norris McHenry reported that $70 had been received from the government for burial lots in Sand Creek Cemetery to bury bodies transferred from the Seymour Airfield.
When somebody died in 1846 and they transferred the body, they did move the tombstones. On top of page 9, you see those tombstones, and it is weird because do you see that gazebo and house in the background? The person that lives there happens to be here today.
How interesting. Okay. Now, one more place we've got to close up, and that is
New Driftwood,
which is a sad situation. Okay, on your map, that's number 3 in the yellow over there. That's the one over here at Jacob County. And way back early in the program, I told you that they had asked to have a meeting over there after this one closed. They said, we're still Quakers, we want a meeting. Something had happened in the Friends Church, in the Religious Society of Friends in Indiana at that time. That's when we changed from the quiet meeting where you only spoke when God had given you messages or you came with a message and all. That is the time that they changed to paid pastors that you called well, which we have. So we're going to go into this new meeting over here is going to have paid pastors. 6 years. After this one closed, this one was established, and let's make sure it did get established. Read me that minute. Al.
Committee appointed to attend the opening of the meeting at Jaketown, known as New Driftwood. Report they attended thereto, and the meeting was accordingly opened and established on the 12th month, 10th day, 1893.
Now, New Driftwood flourished for a number of years. It is important that you find page 4. The reason it's important, up at the top is a picture of the Driftwood meeting in the early 1900s. And I'm sorry that the bottom picture is bad, but it's the best I could do. In the bottom picture, you see a nice tree. That tree's still there today. You see a nice pole. That pole is still there today. And there are 4 people. Here is Carolyn, there's Steve, here's Norman, and here's Andy that are standing on the foundation, the 4 corners of the foundation that we could find in 1996. And it happens that Steve and Carolyn are here today. That's also weird. Now more weird, I mean more wonderful. On this page is a picture of the beloved, dedicated Christian pastor who lived in Azalea, but he pastored this meeting, the New Driftwood meeting, for many years. And today I have sitting in the audience 2 of his great-granddaughters. One of them came here from Cincinnati just to be special. And I don't know where, let's see, that's Susan. Barbara, where do you live?
I have a nice town.
Oh, you're still in Nice?
Yeah.
You're still in Nice town. I happen to know this, and of course, this is his granddaughter-in-law, their mother. I happen to know them when we lived in Nice town, and that's why it was so, I so wanted him here today. Because he was a beloved pastor, but you three need to close your ears for what happened now.
Okay.
When he died in the mid, well, he died in 1928, but he, at the age of 91, but when he became so he couldn't pastor, but he pastored there for 30-some years, and the meeting flourished, but when he was gone, the meeting declined. Other pastors tried to keep it going, but now it gets sad. Al, I need to get my tissue out so I can cry. Read what happened. 1932. I'm not alive yet.
Clarence Davis is present and gave a report of his work in the New Driftwood Church, where a federated community church has been organized. This meeting asks the trustees to cooperate with the officials of this new organization in regard to the use of the improvement of Friends property at New Driftwood.
It
is no longer a Friends meeting. It is now a Confederated Community Church. It is no longer, you've got your eye, your ears closed. It's no longer a Friends meeting. And 18 months later, it's more disturbing. I've got to get my tissue out. I'll read the last minute, and then you have done a great job.
The trustees of the monthly meeting recommend that the monthly meeting inform the new Driftwood community they should restore peace and harmony in their church work. If this is not accomplished, the monthly meeting holds the right to close the door of the church.
Now see, that community church was using Friends property. So if they don't shape up, they said they were going to close the doors. Now, I have no more record in the minutes. And remember today, everything I've told you has been in the minutes. I'm sorry to stop on a sad note. Some of you here today may be interested in genealogy. If you're interested in genealogy, if you're not interested in genealogy, forget it. But if you're interested in genealogy, on the back page is how you can contact the Sand Creek Azalea meeting, which holds these records because you see, you read, you heard the minute where Driftwood was simply renamed Sand Creek. And that's how we come to have these records in our fireproof cabinet. And they are available for any genealogist to come and see as long as they don't leave the meeting house. And I would be delighted to come meet you there and help you try to find what you're looking for. Now, I want to thank the Seymour Library. You've made a comfortable room, and I have to credit them for doing the white pages, of producing these white pages for my brochure. I must thank Tony and his family. I love y'all. I must thank Pat. Thank you for representing the women's minutes. Now remember, there were women's minutes and men's minutes. And Al, you did a good job. You didn't even have to drink much water, did you? And I thank Marcy and Sierra for passing out our programs. And I am amazed. I truly thank you for paying attention. That's wonderful. All right. When my husband and I moved to Seymour in 1993, we enjoyed the opportunity of seeing the beauty of southern Indiana. We loved to get in our car on a balmy fall day and drive to somewhere in Jackson County that we had not explored. My challenge to you is, for you who live here in Jackson County, that you do the same thing on a beautiful spring day. Take this map. Go see those places that I talked about today. And let that be your celebration of the bicentennial of Jackson County. And for you who are from Bartholomew County, Hancock County, Johnson County, Marion County, Rush County, Henry County, yeah, I'm getting tired, and Cincinnati, Ohio. Explore your area and value your heritage. But for everybody except for Susan, let the rest of us all celebrate the bicentennial of Indiana. Thank you.